No, the question
but
here
Manish,
which
Himachal Pradesh sends 3 members of parliament to Lok Sabha. Gujarat sends 25 members of parliament to Lok Sabha. Next, you'll compare Mizoram and Uttar Pradesh. I mean, what is the point that you're making?
Well, Navika, again, your argument is self-defeating. Because for the simple reason that if you look at 2004 and 2009, you know, the Congress has returned, or the Gujarat has returned, you know, between 12 and 14 members of parliament from the state of Gujarat. So therefore, that is an oxymoron and a self-defeating argument.
I take your point. Take your point. However, our panelists have some important points to make here, especially on your observation that it's -1 for the BJP. Let's go across to this corner here, to Swaminathan Iyer and Vinod Mehta first. Either of you, or maybe Swami first. Well, yes.
Let me start with a question to Arun Jaitley, if he's there.
Arun Jaitley, we just lost the satellite link and we're going to come back to him.
But, you know, it seems to me that Modi's first attempt to be campaigning outside Gujarat, he went to Himachal Pradesh. He had avoided campaigning earlier in Uttar Pradesh or in Punjab or Uttarakhand.
True.
His first attempt to go outside, it has been a very, very poor performance. Does this not show that, you know, the evidence may not be massive, but on the first evidence, Modi's Midas touch disappears the moment he leaves Gujarat.
Solid point, but Mr. Jaitley is not there with us. We'll come back and put that question the moment he's back. Vinod Mehta, what's your response to Manish Tiwari, who has made 3 points here today? One, wherever Rahul Gandhi goes, he wins. B, he says that at the end of the day, it's even Stevens or it can be looked at -1 for the BJP. Vinod Mehta to Manish Tiwari.
No, Manish is a friend and I am not a critic of the Congress party. But I think it's a bit sad at the kind of convolution the Congress is making to draw some comfort out of the Gujarat results. And to claim that Mr. Rahul Gandhi was a great success in Gujarat and had he campaigned somewhere else.
Yes.
They didn't put his photograph in any of the posters in Gujarat, by the way. So, I mean, listen, there is some grace in defeat. I think the Congress should accept that they have done badly.
There was no grace in defeat today?
I think when they say something like this, that Rahul campaigned, wherever Rahul campaigned, he won.
Yes.
I think they demean Rahul. I mean, it's an insult to Rahul to say that he campaigned in 7 constituencies.
But to that question, I put another question. Does Modi thrive on personality clashes? And in that sense, is Rahul Gandhi's refusal to engage him a Congress party masterstroke? That's the question which I'd like to put to this side of the panel. Because it can also be looked like that, can't it? That Modi wants a personality clash. You don't engage him?
No, so then you don't fight an election? You say you're fighting an election. What kind of a masterstroke is this? That you lose out on your vote share, you give up the entire state, and then you say that I'll come back in 2014 and see you. I wasn't even fighting this battle. Then what are we discussing if you're not discussing
electoral outcomes? He hasn't said I wasn't even fighting this battle, has he, Hartosh? He's not said that.
That's entirely the problem, isn't it? Because, I mean, they keep talking about Rahul as the leader of the future. It seems he always has been the leader of the future. He always will be. I mean, when is he going to step up and say, this is where I stand?
Manish Tiwari, Manish Tiwari.
One small point. Congress strategist.
Arti, please. Arti.
And tell me, if Modi becomes the face of the BJP's or NDA's campaign in 2014, will Rahul shy away from being the face of the Congress campaign?
I think it's best if Manish Tiwari answers that now. Everybody on the panel needs a clarity on that.
Arnab, if I was a Congress strategist, instead of saying that wherever Rahul campaigned, he won, I would say that perhaps we should have made Rahul campaign more.
But Manish Tiwari is not saying that.
But I'm saying that's not a much better alibi.
You're not a Congress.
To say that in the 7 constituencies that he campaigned, he won.
We are waiting
in the campaign.
By the way, we are still waiting to get the video link back with Mr. Arun Jaitley, who we lost there, so that we can put our questions on the BJP there. But come on, Manish Tiwari, give us a direct answer on that. So many people are increasingly beginning to ask.
You know, to what Mr. Vinod Mehta
has said. Does Rahul Gandhi aspire for political office?
No, you know, to what Mr. Vinod Mehta had said, I think it would be fair and magnanimous, you know, to concede, you know, what is a statistical fact. you know, I had plotted a graph. And as every politician, you know, you have a right to do your own sophology. And I found that, yes, you know, he had campaigned across 13 constituencies. In all those 13 constituencies, the Congress won. I don't know why is everybody taking such a big umbrage to that. You know, it is a statistical reality. And how much ever you may fulminate on it, it does not take away from that fact. And number two, you know, to this big...
My question, which I want to go to Arun Jaitley, which is my next question, is this.
You know, a lot of your panelists ask questions. I am answering the personality clash question, and the answer is as follows. You know, what I had said earlier, that the Congress party's politics and programs are not decided, or strategy is not decided, by whom the opposition decides to field against us. After all, Mr. Atal Bihari Vajpayee, with all due respect to him, led the NDA campaign in 2004. The NDA bit the dust. You had Mr. Advani, you know, leading the campaign in 2009. Again, with all due respect to him, you know, and I don't want to, you know, sound arrogant or anything of that sort, but he remained the Prime Minister in waiting. So therefore, the Congress party's strategy has never been dependent upon what or whom the opposition decides. That's their problem. Insofar as we are concerned, when 2014 happens 13 months down the line, you know, we will go to the people based upon the strength of our own track record and our own policies and what we have to offer in the future.
Well, I take your point. Now, one second. We have Mr. Arun Jaitley back. Mr. Arun Jaitley. In this election, there were some people who came and said, you know, Yogendra Yadav among them, they made the observation that this is the dark face of democracy. And I think they also said that Narendra Modi's victory poses unique challenges for India's democratic process. And when we asked them to elaborate, the question was put in the context of 2002. Now, Mr. Jaitley, some BJP representative, sorry, it's a long question, responded to that by saying there's an anti-Modi industry which is on in Delhi. I want you candidly to your observations on the strong criticism that Narendra Modi still faces, and whether you think Narendra Modi will inevitably have to change his image, do a few things in order to be acceptable at the national level. Mr. Jaitley.
Well, Narendra Modi is what Narendra Modi has been. And therefore, I think the very fact that such an argument can be given, this argument itself is a dark face of democracy. Here you have somebody who in last three elections has successfully led the BJP to victory in the state. So he's got the electoral mandate three times over. And therefore, you have a comment being made, notwithstanding these victories. These victories itself will represent the dark face of democracy, and those who are unelectable in other sense are the real representatives of democracy. I don't think this argument cuts much ice. As far as Gujarat is concerned, 2002 was a very unfortunate episode, but Gujarat has travelled beyond 2002. Look at the history of Gujarat in the earlier 30-40 years preceding 2002. There were a lot of caste tensions. There were a lot of religious tensions in Gujarat. Last 10 years, haven't seen a single day of curfew. Today, Narendra Modi has transformed Gujarat into a state with aspirational politics. And if you ask me to define what this present vote is, every Gujarati sees Gujarat as a hugely developing state. He has an aspiration that my state is moving forward. And here is a leader who's really leading it in that direction. Now, therefore, when you have this kind of a change agenda in Gujarat, and the 2012 election was all about that, I think Gujarat has grown out of 2002. Narendra Modi is far away from 2002. It's just that some people refuse to see that kind of a change in Gujarat and would like to see the Gujarat showcased only in the 2002 scenario.
Mr. Tiwari, would you concede that Narendra Modi fought this time on a development placard? And hence, therefore, perhaps you should also reassess, as the BJP clearly says, your attempts to limit Narendra Modi in the 2002 paradigm. Would you agree that Narendra Modi has moved beyond 2002, as Arun Jaitley puts forth?
Well, I think, Arnab, those are two parallel tracks. You know, there is still a sense of closure which needs to be brought about with regard to the program which happened in Gujarat in 2002. And let's not forget the fact that systematic attempts were made to subvert the process of justice. It is only when, you know, trials were shifted outside Gujarat, when the Supreme Court intervened, that the whole judicial machinery, you know, swung into motion. So therefore, that is a fact which nobody can detract from. And insofar as Mr. Modi traversing the paradigm is concerned, may I respectfully point out that the only thing that we need to go back to the drawing board on is to how we can engage better, you know, with the urban segments of the Gujarat population, because that's been a shortcoming which goes back because of historical reasons, and that's something which we really need to introspect upon. And the point which Mr. Iyer was making earlier, when you lost the satellite link.
Before I go back to the point on Mr. Iyer, the only foray that
Mr. Modi made outside Gujarat to Himachal Pradesh, you know, came a cropper.
One second. Before I saw a strong sense of disagreement from Mr. Arun Jaitley when you were speaking about the 2002 pogrom, and what you said was a subversion of the justice delivery system after that. I'd like to go back for a quick rebut on that point to Mr. Arun Jaitley, please. Mr. Arun Jaitley, would you like to comment on that observation of Mr. Manish Tiwari regarding 2002?
This is an often repeated historical error which the critics of Gujarat really believe. Compare 2002 and the judicial accountability with regard to 2002. You had the state police which registered thousands of cases. Then you had the Supreme Court intervening, the SIT which went into the question. You had a state SIT, you had a central SIT, you had courts after courts scrutinizing. You couldn't find a shred of evidence against Modi except for a political propaganda against him. And even the cases which have gone on in Gujarat, some people have been punished, some people have been acquitted, the appeals are pending, the due process of law is on. But then to paint the judiciary of Gujarat that nothing happens. Now compare this with what happened in 1984. The kind of judicial accountability, the judicial scrutiny, the kind of repeated layers of investigation in 2002, please compare it with 1984. Not hardly has any person been convicted. For years you didn't have FIRs, you didn't have people being charge-sheeted. You had a Chief Justice of India who was appointed a commission of inquiry, Justice Ranganath Mishra, who almost said that there was no breakdown of the law and order machinery. He couldn't identify a single guilty person. It's only even 25, 27 years after that, you still have families grieving for justice. The magnitude of the tragedy was much larger, and therefore Mr. Tiwari would do well, he is also a very good lawyer, to compare 1984 and the judicial accountability in 1984 and the kind of judicial scrutiny which has taken place in 2002.
You need to respond to that, Mr. Tiwari. And then there is one question which Swaminathan Iyer had for Arun Jaitley, which we'll come to after. Two questions for Arun Jaitley from Swaminathan Iyer and Vinod Mehta. But would you like to respond on the 1984 issue? I just want Mr. Tiwari to respond directly to Mr. Arun Jaitley.
You know, I think what happened in 1984 was absolutely horrendous. You know, it is something which cannot be condoned by any civilized society. And if, unfortunately, after so many years, there has been no closure in the case of a lot of victims, and I can say that, you know, with a tremendous amount of conviction, because I'm a part of that process of pain which Punjab suffered all those years, you know, is a blot on our society. But one thing I would like to ask Mr. Jaitley, do two wrongs make a right? You know, at least the Congress leadership had the courage to stand up and say that what happened in Delhi in 1984 was reprehensible, it is regrettable, it was said by the Congress president, it was said by the Prime Minister, not once but repeatedly on the floor of the House. But have you ever heard a single word of remorse from any BJP leader, you know, least of all Mr. Narendra Modi, who is the Chief Minister of Gujarat, on whose watch this entire program took place?
I think Mr. Tiwari, besides being a clever politician, is a more clever lawyer, the question addressed to him was, compare the judicial scrutiny of 1984 and the standard that the judiciary in India applied to 1984 with the different layers of judicial scrutiny on 2002. He fails to answer that question. He refuses to answer that question and says, did you condemn it? Of course, Mr. Vajpayee condemned it. The BJP condemned it. Nobody was happy with 2002. But therefore, that still doesn't answer the question which I had posed to Mr. Tiwari, where he speaks in the context of 2002 in Gujarat, to say that the entire judiciary of Gujarat can be painted black and therefore no justice was possible under that judiciary. People have been convicted by that very judiciary itself.